This time on Andy's Motorcycle Obsessions, Milton gives me a shim and I did this. Thank you, Milton. All right, 0.15 just fits in. 0.2 does not fit in, so we are in spec. That is awesome. I've got a 0.18 here. Yeah, 0.18 is about where it's at. So that's it. Thank you very much, Milton. So we are now at, got all of our valve clearances. So now I just need to do a couple of other little jobs. Right, so I've been around the four of those. They're all at 20 Newton meters. And now we just do the timing chain. So we wind him around clockwise until the C lines up with the timing mark. And then we release the bolt, make sure it's in the right position. And we tighten that to six Newton meters. Then we tighten the locking nut, and we've got to make sure that we don't screw the main retaining bolt. Okay, that's done. Engine's back together. Bike is full of fuel. Bike is full of oil. I'm going to test fire it. I'm only going to run it for a few seconds and then I'm going to shut it off and then we're going to have a talk about engine braking. Okay, let's talk about engine braking. The last time I did the top end rebuild, I only spent a couple of $100. Wasn't overly concerned. I just broke the motor in and away we went. This engine I spent a few $1,000s on, so I want to make sure that we do this right
and that it's going to last and perform at its maximum for as long as possible. You need to make sure that you brake your engine in properly. Now, it's not some big mythical science. A lot of people are frightened of this. The fact is that all you're trying to do, if this little drawing here represents the piston inside the barrel. So the black is the piston, the green is the rings, and the red is the barrel. And the reason the red's a wriggly line is because it's not smooth. If you looked at it under an electron microscope, you would see that the crosshatches that the engine reconditioners put in there will look like a squiggly line. It's not a smooth surface. So what we want to try and do is break all the tips off those and also the profile of the ring and get it to match. Now, the best way to do that is using cylinder pressure. And the only real way to get cylinder pressure is to put the engine under load. But the byproduct of putting it under load is heat, and heat's your enemy. Because if these rings get really hot, you can work hard on them and they will glaze. So you won't get that perfect seal that you're looking for. Now, you're never going to create a perfect seal inside an internal combustion engine either, which is why I got in an argument, well, let's say a spirited debate with a guy when I was doing the exhaust video. If you go and look in the comments there, I made the comment that engines don't suck. And it's true, they're not a vacuum pump. An engine, the biggest killer of power is friction, and it takes a lot of power to create a vacuum. It's almost impossible to get right down to a perfect vacuum. So the way that an engine's designed to operate is that when it's on any of the strokes other than the compression stroke and the power stroke, there's very little resistance to the friction of the rings on the cylinder. So where the seal comes from is that the gases during compression and also during the firing stroke work their way around the back of the ring and they blow them out against the cylinder wall. That's where your seal comes from. But when they're in the other strokes, including the intake stroke, there's very little tension on those rings and they don't create a great seal. If you can imagine you've got an atmosphere of 15 psi and you've got a cylinder in a chamber, you wind it down, that air's going to just replace the space where the piston took up, and that's all that's happening in an internal combustion engine. So the intake stroke, it pulls down. Yes, it will create a negative pressure because the diameter of the piston is greater than the diameter of the valve and all of the obstructions. So it will try and draw a little bit of air in there, but mostly you're relying on the pressure energy of the air coming through the venturi. We digress. So you actually only have minutes to break an engine in, not days or hours or weeks. You've got minutes to do that initial break-in. So what you want to try and do is put the engine under load for periods of time. Don't go above about third to half throttle for a while, and just sort of load it up in too high a gear or going up a hill somewhere, and then back it off and let it engine brake, and that'll cool it back down again. Then you go again, and you keep doing that for about 20 to 50 kilometres, I suppose. And then you can increasingly bring your RPMs up, but you don't want to hold them at one RPM for too long because you'll cause that glazing, and you want to be able to, you know, cool off the rings and everything else by backing the throttle off. Probably the best way to do it's on a dynamometer. I've got a couple of issues with that though. One, the guy that I did the dynamometer run with, Red, if you remember back to the torque and RPM and horsepower video. If you didn't see it, click on the card up in the corner. Fortunately, Red has had a tragic accident on his sidecar racing at Simmons Plains in Tasmania. And currently, we're not quite sure what's happening with his business or his health, and we wish him well. But it means that I won't be able to go there. Two, I'm running out of time. I've only got a couple of weeks now until the next rally for XS1100 Australia National Rally, and I'm riding that bike 3,500 kilometres round trip to go to it. So I need to get it sorted and make sure that it's all shook down and everything's okay. I don't have oil leaks. I don't have something, clearance issues. I'm going to squeeze and see something horrible. So I need to get on the bike and start riding it. There is another dynamometer, Shazzy dynamometer in Hobart, at another business in here. And I've spoken to the guy, and they really know their stuff, but I've only got one pay packet between now and the rally. So I can't really justify or afford the $150 an hour to do the break-in. So I'm just going to do it on the road. Now, oil. Back in the day, they used to recommend using a single-grade oil or a mono-grade oil. Pretty hard to buy one, at least in Hobart. Most of the motorcycle oils are multi-grades. Now, the difference is that they add a polymer to it. So what happens is that it thickens as it gets hotter. So they can refine it so that it's light enough to pour and be pumped when it's cold, but as it gets hot, it doesn't get too thin. Now, it's not going to cause us any grief. What will cause you grief, though, if you use a synthetic oil, because it's too slippery to effectively try and run this engine in. So you want to be using a mineral-based oil, and in an XS1100, you want to use mineral-based oils anyway, particularly for the clutch and the starter, cush drive, etc. So, yes, that's what I do. And then after about 30 kilometres, this engine's going to be full of metal. So there will be all of the scrapings from the side, from the wall of the barrel, plus the wear from the rings, and possibly some from around the cylinder head as well, because I've got brand new valves and everything in there, so it may take a while to seat everything in. So after about 30 k's or so, I'm going to dump the oil, put a brand new filter in it and brand new oil in it, and then I'll probably change it again once before I go up to New South Wales. All right, so I'm going to go for a ride now. Yes, as I said, so you want to build cylinder pressure, but not leave it hanging too long under load. Let it cool down, build cylinder pressure, let it cool down. That's the best way to do it. It's not some mythical black art. All we're doing is trying to wear the rings into the barrel so that we've got a perfect seal, and the best way to do that is with cylinder pressure. So just... build cylinder pressure. Pretty hard on a bike like this to be in the wrong gear. I'm in fifth. So you got to try and get it to labour a little bit, but you don't, by the same token, you really don't want to be chugging it along in way too high a gear. Got a little bit of a hill here, so I can kind of just chug it along, build that cylinder pressure, back off, let the rings cool down. The whole bottom end of this engine and transmission and everything's already running. If you had a brand new bike, you'd be by backing off the engine, you're also putting forward load on your gears. Come on, Mr. Volkswagen, how much bloody room do you need? By riding it in different gears, it's a way of varying your RPMs at the one speed limit. So you can sort of maintain speed, but change your RPMs by changing gears. Thank you.
some school of thought about the hard baking process that includes, and some dynamometer runs out. If people who build engines for maximum performance will probably subscribe to this theory that after you've spent a few minutes breaking in the rings to the bore, you should give it some full throttle runs. And the theory behind that is that you introduce rod stretch, etc., and you throw the piston as high in the cylinder as it's ever going to get. And that knocks all the carbon buildup, etc., off the bore and keeps it clean there and allows the rings to bed into that area of the bore as well, so you don't scratch your rings up at the top of the stroke. We're not doing that today. Err on the side of caution. The other thing I haven't actually done yet, and I probably should have, is check the vacuum advances working. So by putting it on a dynamometer, you have the ability to create a lot more rolling resistance with a dynamometer inertia wheel, inertia drum. A lot more than you can on the road, so you can build greater cylinder pressure and therefore, you know, obviously have a better result. But it's not essential. Now the engine's sort of up the temperature. I'm going to pull up the road here and just have a quick look around, make sure we don't have any oil leaks. We don't have any funny noises. I can't hear anything. The motor sounds good. Oh, there is a squeaky noise. I don't like squeaky noises. Coming from this side of the motor. I reckon it's a tight bucket. Hopefully that's all it is. All right, engine's cooled down. I can touch it. That's really not good. Something's tight. Get home, see what we can find.